Hello and welcome to another Three Cameramen Productions. Well, we're doing another podcast for you today. Obviously, as you know, episode 12 was Spirited Away, so we're going along that same sort of vein. And we go for Howl's Moving Castle.
It got loads of views, and we need the views because it's a good film.
We do need views. So as always, I'm joined by Owen.
Hello, I am here.
And we have a special guest today. We got Alice. Do you want to introduce yourself?
What's up, lads? My name's Alice. I love Ghibli movies. And ever since Spirited Away, I have been cursing Daniel to watch Howl's Moving Castle so that I could be a guest. So, yeah.
Yeah, that happened. And I hated Spirited Away.
I think that's the first guest we've had who's actually given an intro, like a proper intro.
Yeah,
all the guests just said no. Or confused.
Just because I'm elite.
Just a notice. Philly might join us later on. We don't know.
If he decides to turn up, basically.
He's a bit irresponsible right now. We just put him in a cage and leave him. To be honest. You two have seen it in both languages, haven't you? The Japanese and English.
Sort of. Yep.
Right.
As it has, yeah. But I've like seen half of it in Japanese.
Yeah, so I'm probably the least qualified to talk about it because I've only seen the original Japanese version. But I just wondered what your kind of initial thoughts were on the film. And we're going to start with Owen.
Why not? Okay, sure. So what did I want to say? So I watched this, same with Spirited Away, about a year ago now. And I watched it because I love Spirited Away so much, because Ghibli, amazing, amazing studio.
Ghibli's terrible.
And I'm just ignore that.
I will fight you.
Out of
the two, I do prefer Spirited Away, but I watched it first time and I watched an English dub, which I think is one of the most amazing like dubs I think in like with like any foreign film I've heard, because of Christian Bale's in the voice. He does it amazing because it's Christian Bale. When I watched first time, for me, the plot was really discombobulated and really all over the place. I wasn't too sure what was happening, and must be because I wasn't paying attention or something like that. But I still remember I loved the feel of the film, like you do with any Ghibli film. I loved the atmosphere, the characters, the music, because it's amazing, amazing music. And then I watched it again for this podcast, and I still love it, but I still think the plot's really discombobulated and a bit frantic. What I noticed is, I'll expand more on this later, it's Ghibli films are not like narrative plots, they're more character plots. They're about the characters, not the actual story, that makes sense. And that's what they focus on more. And the character development in this film is amazing. But yeah, I've talked enough now. Over to you, Alice, your initial thoughts.
Okay, I think this movie's great. And I kind of agree with what Owen said about the plot. I feel like sometimes it can be a bit confusing. Like, for example, suddenly Sophie just has to go to the castle, and then the interaction with the Witch of the Waste. I feel like sometimes it can be very sporadic and very random, but I feel like in terms of Ghibli films, they're never really about the plot. They're more about the aesthetic and the kind of the feel of the feeling of what the movie gives you. So obviously, there's character development. You see the development of Howl, who kind of realizes that the beauty that matters is the beauty within, and all of that. The music is amazing. Like, it's just like, it's very popular. I mean, the main theme, the merry-go-round theme is very popular, especially on social media, like TikTok. It's very popular and rightfully so, because it's very nice. The art style is perfect. The characters, you know, it gives a really good message of, you know, don't be shallow and stuff.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
I'd say, although I do prefer Spirited Away because it's just like one of the first Ghibli films I saw, it is a very iconic movie, and it's very comforting in the way it makes you feel. So, yeah.
And Daniel, let's see your opinion.
Well, so obviously I've spoken about Spirited Away before and how I basically didn't like it, and that was the first Ghibli film I saw. But I think it's actually better that I saw that before this, because I kind of knew what I was expecting when I got into it, and therefore I think I realised how good it actually was kind of while watching this, because I had very high expectations for Spirited Away because of how people call it a masterpiece, but then it was just something I totally didn't expect. Whereas this was definitely, even with like the art style and the music, it was kind of on a similar sort of vein to Spirited Away.
Mm.
And even just kind of just how out there the kind of plot is. Like, who thinks of like a moving castle that looks like the Ninkinong from In the Night Garden? Like, moving across like a secret garden and then a girl, I don't know.
It's so clever. It's so clever.
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, definitely.
Sorry, off the finish point.
Music was great. Animation was great. I did get a bit lost, kind of, I think like half an hour before the end. I just kind of, I don't know. It's just lost interest for me. But yeah, I thought it was actually a pretty decent film.
Well, obviously it's quite a genius idea, but I was doing some research into it. So the reason why it's quite discombobulated is, as I said, like, I think Japan in general will have different narrative styles than we do, in terms of like, it's more character-centered than plot-centered. But they also, this entire film was based on a trilogy of books. Like, the entire thing was like, all trilogies were pushed into one book, into one film, sorry. So it would have always been a bit messy, regardless of whether they were going for plot or characters. But luckily the characters are so well developed in this, like beyond belief. I mean, Spirited Away, I do obviously prefer that film loads, like, a lot more, but the characters felt not disconnected, but they felt quite, like, you always saw them at face value for most of them. Like, there's obviously many exceptions, but like, for most of the main characters. But in this film, each character is given depth, and that makes it like, really builds the world building.
Yeah. I agree, especially in terms, like, going back to like dubbing. Like, usually a lot of anime dubs are a little bit questionable, but I feel like with the Ghibli dubs, they're very well done, and especially with the casting choices. So Christian Bale, also Calcifer, the fire demon, is played by Billy Crystal, who is Mike Wazowski. And I just think the characters, like the voices, really help you connect if you don't like having like subtitles. The dub is very good, so I definitely recommend listening to it.
That's quite interesting, actually, because obviously I watched it with subtitles with the Japanese original, and I have to say, the fire demon was definitely like one of my favorite characters, and like, I just think, especially in comparison with Spirited Away, I just found the characters just a lot more interesting in general. Like, even, I mean, I watched the English dub of Spirited Away, and the girl's voice was annoying all throughout, and that was just hideous. But like,
don't diss Chihiro like that, man.
The Japanese voices are just, I guess, just more authentic to me, and that's probably why.
Yes,
I preferred it to watching the other one.
Yeah, sometimes you connect more with the Japanese voices because obviously it was written that way.
Yeah, definitely.
And also, like, back to the characters, like, Ghibli has of like continued the streak with like these really like idiosyncratic, like really whimsical characters.
Right, iconic.
Yeah, that's where the films stick out so much. We have obviously the turnip head. You have what's it called, Calcifer. Yeah, Calcifer.
Yeah, Calcifer.
Are just like amazing.
They were the two best characters. Definitely.
Yeah. I forgot what I was gonna say.
I quite like.
Okay. Go for it, Daniel. To the floor.
Okay. I was gonna go for kind of the villain side of it. So kind of the antagonists of the film.
Okay.
I thought definitely were much more developed than in Spirited. I mean, I keep comparing it to Spirited Away, but I feel like that is a fair comparison. So in Spirited Away, there's a lot of moments where there's kind of not really like. You don't see the evil that's like about to happen, whereas with Howl's Moving Castle, you've obviously got the constant threat of all these kind of flying machines and the war that's going on at the time. And I feel like that kind of.
What do you mean? You do have the constant threat. Baba.
In Spirited Away.
This is what I mean.
No, like in Spirited Away, it will play through most of the film, and then at some point, a random wrinkled man rises out.
There's
a weird wrinkled face that rises out of a bar.
Yeah, that's the thing is, I don't know if we watched the same Spirited Away, but this isn't about Spirited Away, but there's a clear villain.
In Spirited Away, the villain is more clear cut. In this one, you have the war, the queen. You have the witch. They're like, those are three villains, and the witch is
sort of like. I feel like they're more developed.
Of course, more developed. No. Because in Spirited Away, the character of the villain is not given much depth, but you realise there's another twin to that, and that gives the character. I've got the words, just like consequently gives it more depth, and that.
I guess I just didn't see that then.
Yeah. And me. I feel like in Howl's Moving Castle, there's not only like physical like villains, so like for example the war and stuff, you also have like the characters themselves and their inner demons and kind of sorting out for example Sophie has her, like, she's not very confident, and throughout the film you see her battle her insecurities so that she feels beautiful, and Howl, his problems with his vanity. I feel like throughout the film you kind of see the characters not only fight the demons in the physical world, like the war and the queen, but also, that's not the queen, that's the witch lady, but also their own in like problems.
It's quite good you mentioned that, the fighting the inner demons, because this film does what I think every child's film should do, like with Pixar and Ghibli, is incorporate real world themes into a lighthearted story mainly. In this film is like chock full with like themes of war. At the start you have like the catcalling, like sexism, depression, self-loathing, image, persistence. Like, it's all works so well. I think the most obvious representation of like depression and like self-loathing is when Howl gets his hair dyed ginger, and he gets all slimy and sticky, like quite repulsive to be around. It's a really great metaphor that is executed so well.
I thought kind of similar to that, just the way it presented kind of like the optimism of Sophie was a lot more prevalent, I thought. So it kind of it clearly showed how she was like overcoming each challenge or whatever, or just like taking it as she went into the challenge. And I thought that was definitely a lot more clearer kind of from the start, like her characteristics.
I feel like it was kind of,
although the Wicked Witch of the West is painted as a villain for turning Sophie into this old creature, I feel like it kind of taught Sophie the lesson that you don't have to be beautiful to have someone love you.
It also, like, speaking of, Finney's entered the room. So before I add him in, I'll quickly say how the film tackles old age and aging in general. Like, it argues that every Asian is beautiful and it should be accepted. And you see that through the persistence and through Sophie and how she just carries on and she appreciates life more as she gets older. And it's really, like, a beautiful thing to see. But let's get Finney's reviews. Let's get him in here.
Hey!
His opinion.
He's joining, hopefully. Finley, you join mid-podcast. What are your opinions on Howl's Moving Castle?
I actually don't know what to say about it. Okay. So obviously I've joined a bit late because I missed watching it a bit early, so I had to watch it through the podcast because, you know, the other guys couldn't wait. But hey,
incompetency, that's the reason.
No,
Finley, you weren't there 10 minutes late.
Yeah, you could have waited an hour and 10 minutes. You could have done something in an hour and
Finley,
10 minutes.
Finley, that's a special opinion.
We did, but
so my opinion is invalid. No joking.
true.
What do you think?
Did you like it?
Did I like it? Not necessarily. I thought it was like some bits I liked, like the music is really like well done. I've heard that track before, so I didn't know it came from that. So that was really cool. And obviously, yes, I don't know. Do you have cinematography in anime?
Yeah, you do.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, the cinematography was nice, and the art design of all the characters
amazing.
The moving castle was really nice. I just thought the plot was very generic. You know, I didn't understand it for like halfway through. Like, did she lose her spell because she just turned back into her?
That's exactly.
She was in a dream. She was in a dream.
No, she wasn't.
I will...
Wait, which bit?
Bit where near the end.
Okay, so okay, I know exactly what he's talking about.
Which bit?
Finley's saying when sometimes you see her gradually like go in and out of being an old woman. right?
Yeah.
So you said, Finn, that you were a bit confused about what happened with her spell, and that's understandable. Okay.
No, there's more. There's more.
I'll explain that. Because the spell is not really making her old. It's just changing her age in conjunction with her mood. Every time she gets a bit of confidence or like she gets a bit of pride and like really stands up for herself, that's when she turns back to be younger, when she has more respect for herself. And she also turns younger in her dreams. And that's almost by the end, where she's permanently a young person again, because she's found her confidence with Hal being together with him. And that's why there's like it's about love and like compassion. That's
like during this bit.
During that bit in Alice's background,
which you can't see, but.
And yeah, Finny, you had more.
Yes. One. So much. Why was there a war? First of all, I guess that's just got. I don't know. You probably.
It was based on Iraq in 2003. That's why.
That's just genuine. It is. It was.
No, it is. I'm not joking.
Hayao Miyazaki was influenced. This was based on a book of trilogy of books, and the war was in those books. It was only included by Hayao Miyazaki after he opposed the invasion of the Iraq War in 2003, and the film came out a year later. So it was heavily by the war and like shown because it is. Well, as we said before you arrived, it's balancing heavy themes really well. And one war and how to deal with war is one of those heavy themes and like the tragedy of it.
Okay, who was Howl's character? Why does he keep turning into like an animal, like a bird?
Because he's a wizard. He's a wizard, so he has the ability to morph.
Again, an amazing.
Why was
segue,
that killing him?
He's fighting in the war. He's getting like shot and all that stuff. And...
Yeah, he's fighting in the war.
So. Okay. Howl, again, isn't the character I didn't really get the first time I watched it because I wasn't sure what he was doing. I like his character in the film. They don't tell you a lot about why something's happening, what's happening. They tell you the basic level of what's happening. The basic level is how is something like a wizard that can turn into a bird or something like that. That's the basis. You have to infer what happens through the little details he gives you and through Sophie's perspective. Because we see what Sophie sees, and Sophie doesn't see all that. I think the only bit we see where Sophie isn't there of Hal is when he's fighting in some of the group of like the bird things at one point, yeah. Like a hell or something.
It's his own, because remember he says that he was fighting with his own kind, so he was fighting other wizards.
Yeah, we only see from Sophie's perspective in the film, and that's why we're not getting told a lot when we have to infer, and that's why this differs so much from like your conventional like animation, like family-friendly film. Which I think is really intriguing to me. But that's why I do appreciate it. It makes it a bit hard to understand what's going on at times.
Okay. The bloody old woman. Why? What was she about?
The Wicked Witch of the Waste.
Yeah. We're not in Wizard of Oz. I don't understand why she's called that.
Well.
It's the Wastelands.
The Wicked Witch of the West in Wizard of Oz.
Yeah, but it's
the Wicked Witch.
I'm guessing that is
she opposes Sophie in the way that Sophie is a person with like complete compassion for everything, despite how bad you treat her, she'll always give you compassion back. She'll always be forgiving and she always helps you out. Same with.
But she put the spell on.
But she still helped her even when she became an old woman.
Because the thing with the Wicked Witch of the Waste is she's very vain, so she cares a lot about looks. So she makes Sophie look old and decrepit. And like, for example, when they arrive at the castle, they blast the old, like they blast her, and she turns into this old lady because it makes her true age.
Mm. Yeah, because exactly, and then she comes this frail old woman who actually finds, and we see this again with Sophie when she comes old. Freedom and peace in being old. She appreciates the fire more. She appreciates everything a little bit more. Especially the fire. She keeps on banging about how much she loves the fire. And then
how much to eat his heart.
Yeah. It's a bit strange, but
I mean, to be honest, my favorite character is the fire guy.
Billy Crystal, Calcifer, amazing.
Oh yeah, Finny. Did you watch the original Japanese or did you watch the English dub?
I watched the Netflix one. The English one.
What
language
were they speaking? Japanese
English.
Or English?
English, okay, you watched it. Because originally it's in Japanese language, it was translated over to English. I watched it on Netflix.
That means that Finney got all the sexy Christian Bale Batman voices then.
Yeah, did you hear all the Batman voices Christian Bale did?
I missed out on that then.
Wait, yeah, Christian Bale
plays Howl.
Yep.
Batman plays Howl. Howl.
Oh, he played Howl.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and Billy Crystal, Mike
Wazowski
was Calcifer, the fire.
Yeah.
Knew it. That's who I knew he sounded like.
Yeah.
I thought he sounded like Donkey for a minute, but then
that's Eddie, I realized. What's his name?
Eddie Murphy.
Yeah, that's it.
And
the changing of houses. What's to do with that?
Change of powers. Why can't you stay in one location? It adds the mystical.
No, that was cool. I like that bit.
It was really cool. It adds the whole mystical and like.
I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying I was confused about it.
Yeah. It adds the whole mystical and because obviously there's so many interesting characters. The whole Ghibli. I shouldn't. This is your first Ghibli film, right? This is your first Ghibli film, Finley, right?
Oh, you're talking to me. Yes.
Yes. So, in all their films, they include these, like, mystical characters who, like, seem quite weird but make the film really stand out. And they have these locations and inventions that really are quite fascinating. And
Can I guess they made Spirited Away?
They did make Spirited Away. Spot on.
Indeed. Which you can see our review of on episode 12 of the channel, if you want to have a look.
I'll stick my video in
We're also on Spotify as well. We're on Spotify.
Go to
just a cheeky little plug in the middle of this. We're now on Spotify under ThreeCameramen and Google Podcasts. And
if you want to save yourself 20 minutes, don't do it.
Finley!
I think a lot of the locations in House Moving Castle, especially near the beginning, they reminded me of Hitman maps, which I don't know if that's a good thing.
that's true.
But especially kind of the like town square, whatever, it was really kind of intricately detailed into like the background, even though that's not kind of a major part of the scene.
just hit with, like, assassinate somebody in the background.
Yeah. I feel like the backgrounds, if you can't tell, the backgrounds are painted. So you have the written, like the drawn, like animations that you can't see it. The drawn animation style. And then on top of that, you have the detail that's put into the backgrounds because they're painted. So I feel like it just kind of adds to the atmosphere and the vibe of the movie.
But the background was so beautiful in the film. Like,
everything. Yeah, I feel like that's why they use all of these locations, is to kind of like show all of, like, the, yeah.
Show off their talent as well.
I mean, the music they got on spot there with, like, I don't know, just music. I don't know what it.
Ghibli never misses with their music.
They never miss.
Every soundtrack is just amazing.
Well, Ghibli don't make the soundtrack, do they?
Yeah, so it's the same composer.
Miyazaki.
Yeah.
Joe Hisahi.
I think he's with Ghibli, I think. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, he's with them. He does all the music.
Amazing composer.
So this film, interestingly, despite its phenomenal score, only got nominated for one Oscar, and it didn't even win, and that was Best Animated Feature.
Oh, wow.
It would have been the 2005 Oscars. So that's a bit of a scandal. It didn't even get like nominated for best score. Speaking about this year's Oscars, where no anime films have been nominated yet, Shaun the Sheep, Farmageddon definitely deserves a spot.
It's a masterpiece and deserves
every. Do you think? I'll go more general here, but like, do you think that anime films are kind of underappreciated by the mainstream?
I'll quickly mention this. Animation is. Japan treats animation as its own medium, not as a genre of film, and that's why it was nominated for any score, because I assume it was all feature films that are nominated for that. But they don't count animation as a standalone medium, which is quite stupid, because it definitely is.
Yeah.
And also, Ghibli didn't get nominated this year for anything, because their last film was a 3D animated thing, and it looked awful. Terrible.
Okay.
It was by the son of Miyazaki, and it looked crap.
But there has been anime films that have come out this year, which people say were robbed by Shaun the Sheep.
Shaun the Sheep Farmageddon sweeping.
Did
Wallace and Gromit? Wallace and Gromit ever win an Oscar?
Yeah.
Did.
Yeah.
You're joking me.
Yeah, I know. It deserves every bit of
claim. The animation is quality, though.
Wallace and Gromit is top tier animation.
Anyway, back to
Housemaid and Castle, which we'll talk about in the first place.
I feel like a lot of anime movies are overlooked because there's a massive stigma surrounding anime. For example, Finley. When we first wanted to watch this, Finley was like, I don't like anime. And I feel like there's a separation between normal anime and 100%, Ghibli. 100%. Ghibli is like the Disney of Japan.
I'll say Pixar Disney, it's
more than just a there's so much that goes into it, like the aesthetic of the the painting in the background, the animation, the scores. I feel like it's just a dream.
Anime is more flashy, I would say. There's more cool transitions and quick cuts and quite smooth backgrounds, not much detail.
Yeah.
And with Ghibli, everything is intricate, it's very traditional, and it works amazing. And that's why I think anime and Ghibli are two different things.
I found this film quite choppy animation. It seemed quite different to what.
Yeah, the animation was really slow.
Put a sock in it.
I'm just saying, this compared to Kung Fu Panda.
I will say.
But that's the whole point. No. It's kind of, it gives the animated intent it is what you say is choppy.
While the paintings are beautiful and deserve to be there, it does restrict the movement in the animation. I think that's what you're talking about, Daniel. It's very hard to... It's hard to do Kung Fu Panda's animation while painting.
Yeah, but it's not Kung Fu Panda.
It's not going to be as fluid because of that.
I suppose that, because my favourite animated film is Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and that was also kind of, I guess you could call it choppy animation. Mm. But that obviously kind of reflects the comic book, so I'm guessing this is kind of the same effect going for these, because it's based on a novel,
a painting almost.
It's like every frame a painting sort of thing. Mm. So that unfortunately concludes to the end of another Three Caramel podcast. Before we leave you guys, we're gonna go around for some ratings of the films and just our fun impressions, and we're gonna start with a special guest, Alice.
All right, I'd just like to say thank you guys for having me. It's been a pleasure. I hope you bring me back, because I feel like I have a lot to say and it's very important.
Definitely.
More important than what Daniel has to say. Anyway, honestly, this film is beautiful. It's such a comfort film when you're feeling down. It's very good for escapists, and I wouldn't like to give it a numerical value because I feel like it's just worth more than that. I just feel like the music is amazing, the cinematography is amazing, the dub casting is amazing, and I just feel like Ghibli never misses, and this is a perfect example of...
They never miss.
Never miss. So yeah, that's what I have to say.
Great review. And do you wanna go to Owen?
Okay. I love this film. I think it's amazing animation, amazing cinematography, amazing colours, amazing music. The plot, I still think, is really kind of messy, but I just... I'm going to give this an 8 out of 10. I think it's not my favourite Ghibli by any means, but it's still a pretty amazing film. Again, as I said, it's a pretty great comfort film as well.
Finney, your opinions?
I'll probably give it a 2.
Okay, moving on. Over to you, Daniel.
I have kind of... I've said a lot of good things. I've said a lot of bad things. I think it's a pretty average film. Definitely preferred it to Spirited Away, which a lot of people hate, but yeah, there you go.
A lot of people hate?
No, and a lot of people hate my opinion of hating.
Yeah,
not
a lot of people
Spirited
will
Away.
Hate you. Yeah. I come in.
Okay. Anyway, but yeah. I'll give Howl's Moving Castle a 6 out of 10.
Nice.
There you go. Thank you for listening. Also, you can find us on Spotify and Google Podcasts now.
Please follow
us
on Spotify.
Please just subscribe.
Once we reach 100 subs, we'll get a mukbang going for you guys.
Thanks, Alice, for coming to the show.
Thank you very
much. It's been a pleasure. I love you all, apart from Daniel.
Great. And we'll see you next time. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.